stories. Very good. Thanks, everybody, for coming out. One request. Everybody, if you could please sign the sheet in the back just so that we know that you attended the meeting, it would be greatly appreciated. It also helps in taking the notes for the meeting as well. So I think what we'll do is we'll get started on the agenda for tonight. Just I want to give kind of a quick overview of the process that takes place from here and what we're going to try to accomplish tonight. Every year at this time, we get together and have a financial forum to talk about an annual review of kind of where we are to date in the current fiscal year, and then looking forward to create guidance for the upcoming fiscal year, which will be fiscal year 18. So what will come of this group of meetings at this time will be some guidance to the town and to the schools as they're putting together their budgets for fiscal 18. We do that for fiscal 18, but we also do this with an eye looking forward, looking out multiple years. So we have an idea of what the finances will look like going forward, and that also has a big impact on the current fiscal year 18. We'll review revenues, free cash, regeneration, a few other things. And the process as it goes on from here is that after this meeting or series of meetings, in November and December, the school and the town departments will build their budgets, constrained by the guidance that we give in terms of what the revenues are looking like. Then a whole series of meetings start called the budget public meetings. The school committee is scheduled essentially in January 9th, 12th, 26th to go over the school department budget. The selectmen meet on the 10th and 11th to go over the town department budgets. We have a placeholder for a financial forum on the 25th of January, if that makes sense or is necessary. And at the end of that process, everything comes together with the town manager. He puts together a budget. That budget is submitted to the finance committee. And then the finance committee starts going through that in detail. We then have a series of public meetings, essentially in March, 1st, 8th, 15th, and 22nd, going through all of the budgets. These are all public meetings. And then on the 22nd, we'll vote the budgets and the warrant articles, all this coming forward to the annual town meeting on April 24th. With that, Bob, can you turn it back to, Sharon, to talk about fiscal 16, please.
So this is our fiscal 16 revenues for the regeneration. So we had just under $1.6 million over budget. Those line items are detailed where they're coming from. And what seems to be somewhat consistent over the last few years is motor vehicle excise, campaign taxes seem to be key contributors to what we turn back when it comes to the revenue side. Motor vehicle is a hard number typically for us to project because it is a declining tax. So you think that at some point you're going to hit a point where it's going to start going down. So we're careful about it. So we've been increasing it by about 4.5% each year, and still we're turning back a lot of money. And what we realized is we're doing a five-year average of actuals to come up with what the number should be, but when the developments were happening, I don't think we really considered how many extra cars were coming into the community by adding those developments. And so you'll see on a slide later on that we are increasing by like 7.8% for fiscal 18 to try and kind of make up that difference because it seems to be turning back so much. Property taxes, we don't have that kind of flexibility. You budget what's on your recap. You just don't have the ability to budget anything differently. And what that means when you see the 272 is that we abated less than what we budgeted for abatements. And so the only way you could change that number is to show a lower abatement number, but then you take flexibility from your assessor, which you don't want. And he does turn it back if he doesn't use it, and we use it in future budgets. So it's not really an area we can really mess with. Delinquent taxes, we don't budget anything for because we don't know when somebody goes delinquent how long we're going to wait to be paid. And the others are kind of various investment income. Is that a negative?
The state aid was.
Oh, the state aid. Well, I'm looking at the 122. Okay. The investment income, we budget. I could be looking. Look it up there. The 122. Is holding money for capital projects. We do not budget for that because then you have a budget that looks up and down. If we're holding money for a capital project, we're not calculating any interest income on those funds.
Sure. Karen, what's the baseline on which 1.57 is? It says 1.57 overestimate. What's that baseline?
What's the exact?
100. What's the magic number that that is over?
I guess I'm not sure what you're asking.
That's the total revenue.
The total revenue.
Oh, baseline. 100 million, yeah.
That's over all revenue then?
Yeah.
And the 7 points, the 7% you're proposing to bump next year in excise taxes, how much of that? I know it's declining, so you can't estimate it. If you look at the last 3-4 years, are we consistently under where you?
We have been, and we've been bumping up the estimate every single year.
Does 7 put you in the sweet part of that, or do you think that we should take a more aggressive posture?
I think that it brings us closer to what we saw this year for actuals. Because that would kind of get us there. I think we were conservative in how we brought it up in prior years, but realizing that we had an addition of a lot of residents by these developments, we weren't considering that each year when we were doing our motor vehicle excise.
And how many delinquencies are in the delinquency column? How many total?
I don't know that off the top of my head. You mean in terms of how many residents are delinquent?
Yeah, how many transactions are in that 359? Handful? Is it many smaller?
There were some that came to the board that were in six figures.
Correct. That's what I'm trying to
figure out. I wouldn't think it's that many.
There's probably a couple of big ones, and who knows how many smaller ones.
I don't know.
That's an unusually high number for 1 year, though.
Yeah, it is.
Second.
What's the charges for service and permits? Is that building permits? What is that?
All kinds of things.
Yeah, they're all different charges for service. It's both into one there.
Oh, not just building, but
no.
So our expenses came in 1.6 under budget, and these are the summaries of the areas where we were able to save. We turned back some capital. We had some extra in our debt service, so we overprojected what we had for debt service. Benefits, $188,000. Income reserve, what's remaining of our income reserve, was $85,000. And down the bottom, all of the departmental turnback, a lot of that I found to be open positions. So if we have somebody retiring, a vacant position, it's open for a period of time, the savings that happen there, we're never going to know that that's going to happen exactly or how much that could be. And that's what most of it is when I look into the detail of a lot of these departments. So this is our free cash. It has not been certified yet, but this is my calculation, and we're still waiting for DOR to get back to us with the certification. But it is in the arena of $9.2 million. Actually, this number was adjusted already in our favor by like $12,000. So about $9.2 million. And when we're looking at our reserves, we always add in the general stabilization fund and income reserves. And then we back up any uses that we might plan to do in November. So we have 139,154 for land uses at town meeting. And then there's a potential for a litigation settlement for the TLT settlement, which could use $1.2 to $2.2 million of free cash. So if we use $1.2 million, you'd have $9.6 million remaining. If we use $2.2, you'd have $8.6 million remaining. But that's still in excess of the 7% minimum that we have in place at this point. Did you have a question?
Yes. Is the high school construction reserve fund included in free cash?
No.
So why is that litigation settlement amount so high?
That's a discussion with FinCom to use some free cash as part of the settlement. In addition to the construction.
About the lower end of that.
Well,
it's a placeholder for the moment.
The range.
Okay.
It's the number that we've been talking about. I don't know if that will be what we actually do, so just give you an idea. So this is a chart of our free cash and how it's grown over the years. And in fiscal 17 and 18, I used a regeneration estimate of 1 million, which is a very conservative regeneration number. And then I also used $1 million for use in the operating budget. And you see that if that was to come to fruition, it would come down. But I say that every year, and yes, we have amazing regeneration. I think I'm good luck.
Hopefully other things.
The numbers are very high, and you think that they'll never continue that way, and they do. And so we're very fortunate.
Well, can I just clarify? So if you say the estimate was
to use a million, but regeneration of a million.
Mm-hmm.
Wouldn't we expect it to be?
If you look at in your packet, there is a chart that gives you a little bit more detail about how this number comes to be. So this, I think it's page three. So this is a free cash chart, and it goes back to 2007. So the first line gives you what you started the year, what the certification was.
Mm-hmm.
And then you'll see a line that shows favorable variance. And you see that this number is very high over the last 4 or 5 years. It had started to climb in 2011 to over 2 million, then we started hitting 3 million. And we're definitely regenerating at an amazing level.
Oh,
but
so
we have been as low as a million, so we consider a million to be a very safe estimate, and we try and be conservative. One thing I think I failed to mention is that when we're projecting our revenues and such, if we make a change that's significant, DOR will push back, and they want you to be on the conservative side. They don't want to see you have to cut your budget mid-year because you were optimistic about what your revenues would be. So if I tried to increase any line by more than, say, 10%, they would definitely require a lot of backup to let that go through. I think I failed to mention that when we're looking at the revenues.
Yeah, but the reason your chart is flat again, yeah, virtually if you consider using million, but then you think you would generate, there's no effect on free cash.
There's no effect, and I feel
so
like we have been covering what we're using.
Right, so it's
bigger.
Almost a contingency.
It's just a
wash. How I've looked at
the
last few years.
It's really
okay.
Hard to know if this will continue. We are somewhat conservative, but I don't think overly conservative. We do get a lot of lucky things that happen for us, and the numbers are huge. I mean, it's undeniable, they're huge. So it looks like we generate over the last 5 years somewhere in the vicinity of $3 million to almost $4 million. That's a lot, and that's not typical. And so it's got to go somewhere. It would have to turn at some point.
And Sharon, you've been adjusting some of your assumptions, for example, the increase in excise tax.
Yeah, as we see things changing, we've been adjusting the estimates, but then we still try and be still a little bit conservative, but they're always on the upswing when we see that it's trending high. And we're also looking at current year and where we are with projection on our current year receipts. Are we ahead? Are we, you know, and that helps us determine where to go with the next year. But it's still, some things are unknown, motor vehicle being one of the harder ones.
Right. So at the end of the day, despite the fact that we are using free cash to support the operating budget, we've more than overcome that amount in the last several years.
We've
on an annual basis.
And we've used very high amounts of free cash. I mean, last year we used for fiscal 17, $2,150,000?
Yeah.
And that's a large number. And then at the November town meetings, we're always adding to it by using more free cash at a subsequent town meeting. So we used $3 million last year. And we regenerated over $3 million, but it's washing. And so my estimate for 17, 18 just shows the washing because that's what's been happening. It's been a wash or maybe an increase of 200 to 400,000. We're going to go up by about 450,000 if my calculation is correct, but it hasn't been certified yet.
In this chart, am I able to see what we use to balance the budget?
Yeah, I'm sorry. In the center, you'll see that there's the town meeting votes, and I'll show you at each town meeting for each year how much was used at each one of the town meetings, and those are deducted. So you'll start your year with whatever was certified. Then you have your favorable variance, and then you will deduct out any uses, and that's how you get to your number.
And the more the subsequent year's budget is what we.
So if it gets voted,
it's
we're in the current year now. So that $2,150,000, we voted it in April, so it comes out as soon as you vote it.
Thank you.
I just want to stop and say a few words about the current fiscal year. On the town side, in early August, we put on a hiring freeze. I should say a selective hiring freeze because there was a couple of positions that didn't allow it to continue. But until the FY18 budget is complete, there was no sense in hiring someone and then telling them in June that they were finished. But you know, exceptions are, for instance, if there's five positions vacant in a department, certainly we're not going to leave all five positions vacant for the next 7 months. There's also been three capital projects rescheduled. Some of these have gotten perhaps a little more notice, some maybe not so much, but was a $1 million Birch Meadow field lighting project that came in, when the bids came in, over budget by a few hundred thousand dollars. So the decision was made just to cancel the whole thing. So $100,000 was spent for site work, for evaluation that will still be valid, you know, should this go forward. But $900,000 effectively was not spent. And some of that, certainly not all $900,000, is in Sharon's regeneration. There would have been a budget over so many years for debt service, and it's not being used. Also in the current year, there was a $350,000 for Killam Field regrading and some parking lot work for a variety of reasons, including the fact that the Killam School is being reevaluated by the MSBA. And in addition, that we're short, some of our vacancies are in two positions that would work on this. We're short staffed to do this work. I just canceled it and deferred it, as you'll see. And lastly, a couple of selectmen's meetings ago, we actually in this room had four different boards meet and decided, at least through a vote up to town meeting, to defer $100,000 of $150,000 of a DPW cemetery design work. Town meeting will ultimately have a vote on that one. The prior two, the first two numbers were approved by town meeting. I'm the one that stepped in. The third one is a suggestion to town meeting in November. Second, or lastly, and I'll certainly get back to this later this evening in more detail, is capital changes, plan changes that were needed in order to accommodate the high school litigation. So to answer some of Dan's questions earlier, from a planning standpoint, $6 million is a settlement, $1.2 million of free cash, $800,000 of construction funds, and $4 million of debt is sort of the default plan to be discussed. So in order to accommodate $4 million of debt paid over 10 years, all that capital that you can see was rescheduled, and there are some details in your packet. But effectively, because of interest, we had to push out $5 million worth of capital in order to accommodate this. And again, I will come back to more discussion on the room.
So on page 5 of your packet, you have the details of our revenues for the next 5 years, our projected revenue. So 72% of our revenues comes from property taxes, and we're projecting 3.1% increase in fiscal 18. That's using a $500,000 growth number. And then from fiscal 19 through 21, we're looking at 3 to 3.1%. And then in fiscal 22, we go up to 3.4% because we start using a $750,000 estimate. And it's the hopes that having that new economic development position in place for 5 years, we might start to see some new growth starting to happen in that fifth year. The local receipts represents 8% of our revenues, and we're seeing a 6.6% increase with our projections. And if you look at the detail, you'll see the biggest of that is the motor vehicle excise, which we have up 7.8% over our projection from the last year. Everything else is going up very small dollars. I mean, some percentage is high, but small dollars, just to kind of match up with what we're seeing as a five-year average for actuals. So in fiscal 19 through 22nd, we have a 2.4% increase on average. It's 2.6%, so it's 2.4 to 3%. And the state aid is our 16% of our revenue, and that is at 2.5%. Based on FinCom guidance, we're doing 2.5%, even if we know that we won't get 2.5% because there's an agreement that we will fund any shortfall with free cash.
Just to add a little color commentary to that, one of the goals of this set of meetings is to allow the schools in the town to budget as best that they can. If there are areas that could fluctuate, particularly after they've done their budgets, we try to put a little bit of a buffer in place so that it's easier for them to do some planning. The two areas where we've talked about doing that so far have been in state aid, and then we'll come to health insurance as the next one in a few minutes.
Mm-hmm. And then 4% of our revenues come from other revenues, which is the bottom section of things like revolving funds for sale of real estate or sale of cemetery lots. That's where funds like that come from, earnings distribution coming from RMLD. And we have that up 2.2%. in fiscal 18, and then just about 1% for the 4 years after that.
Why the bump at 18 that doesn't continue? Why the 2.2 or 18?
Because we increased the overlay surplus $500,000, and then it stays flat.
One question, John, state aid, what, the last couple of years, how close to that 2.5% have we come?
Just over 1%.
Right, so that's rather aggressive.
But it gives us a consistent number across. So this slide shows the increases year over year without considering free cash usage. And you'll notice that on the bottom, we discussed what the percentage would be in fiscal 18 with the different levels of free cash use. So for $2 million, we actually see 2.99%, which is, if you look at 3.24% less than what we would have without free cash, and that's because we used $2,150,000 last year, so it's not level. We're actually going down in our free cash use. So these are the different levels of increase with the different levels of free cash use. So 1 million, 1.89%, 1.5 million, 2.44%, and then if we use no free cash, 0.79, very small increase.
Go ahead, Paul.
Can you explain those numbers on top again?
If you were looking at page 5,
yeah.
If you look to the bottom, these kind of will be off like by like maybe a 10% total operating revenues without the free cash would be those bottom, and those increases are the ones that you would see on the slide. So this one's off a little bit.
Yeah, so I'm just but I'm even confused without the free cash.
So when we're not considering that we're going down on free cash, so not considering free cash at all, where would our increase of revenues be each year? And so 3.24, 2.89, then we start
to
take
it out of all the equations.
Yeah, so
never
the total of all
the
total of all the revenues without talking about free cash, but once you look at reducing your free cash, you're kind of
so you even reduced it
down.
Virtually half.
Yeah.
I get it.
If we were targeting roughly level services, the revenue increase number we're looking at is about 3.6%. Is that?
I think for the purposes of the override discussion, we figured 3.5%.
So we can see none of them are close to that number.
And now we'll turn to pages 6 and 7 of your tonight's handout. Benefits, and I am going to circle back to health insurance in a bit, but benefits generally drive our economy and costs just over 5% for FY18. It's not too bad. When we discuss health insurance, you'll see why, but in the future, 6.3%. And much like the state aid assumption, our health insurance assumption going forward is 7.5%, with an understanding from FinCom that any increases above 7.5% will be met with free cash use. The combination of capital and debt, and this is certainly a discussion for FinCom tonight, just for purposes of this, I've continued for the third year, if you will, pushing a little bit of capital into the operating budget, so it's approximately $250,000. FinCom, and certainly it's up to them, and we'll come back to that later. Out-of-district special education, about 5%. Energy, just a little under 5%. And there's a bunch of miscellaneous things like insurance that don't rise quite as fast, between 2 and 3%. To talk about health insurance, I thought it would be instructive. Every so often, we try to look more broadly and look backwards as well. This is a look at all of our peer communities, so-called, and it's from FY7 through FY14. Which is the latest period the state had all this data available for all these communities. Clearly, there are some unusual data in here. Belmont and North Andover at the two extremes, I'm sure there's something that went on there that didn't really make sense. They may have added, for instance, in Belmont, suddenly added their light department to this number, and they didn't used to have them. I'm just making that up, I don't know. I'm sure their health insurance did not go up 14% annually for that many years, because Belmont would have been bankrupt by now. But you can see that going backwards, health insurance has not been the big problem for all of us, generically. We've actually done better than our peer average. 4.6% is the average, we're 4.2. And a number of these communities are in the GIC. I estimated yesterday for a meeting about a third are in the GIC. So health insurance in the rearview mirror, again, has been challenging because while we say 4.2, look, isn't that great? Well, it's a lot more than those revenues that Sharon just told you about, so it's a problem. But compared to what you hear in the national economy of increases that are unbelievable, I mean, 20% in the private market, we're nowhere near that, thank goodness. The problem is, how do we look at this going forward? I don't think there's any way that we could justify saying, let's just budget 4.2% for the next 5 years based on what's going on in the country. So after a discussion this summer with the Finance Committee, we agreed that 7.5% is a reasonable number. Forecasts of health insurance inflation are higher, but we generally have done better than the national forecasts, and we have some ability to negotiate with our unions to try to shift costs around. And again, with the understanding that if a 9% comes in at 7 instead of a 7.5, we're not going to know that until March, which is very disruptive to the budget process, as Mark said. So the default is in March, the Finance Committee will add the difference in free cash to whatever number might come in that's higher. And there was a past understanding, if we ever got to use this, that if it's less than 7.5%, we'd reduce the use of free cash. We haven't had the opportunity to use that in a while, but it's still possible. The unions and I did meet this week and discussed that we're going to have a small working group work through the winter on some options for our current health insurance to try to probably bring down our premiums. But basically, the message in health insurance from anyone who's in the business is that nobody knows what's going on, and there are no more levers to push to reduce your costs to any reliable degree. Whether that changes after the national election, I don't have a clue. But very experienced consultants that used to be able to give you insight as to if you do this, if you change your ER visits from $50 to $200, you'll save 0.3%. And we did a lot of that. Those discussions do not happen anymore. They do not exist. We do have the only two options we really have within the current plan we have is to go for a third option up in what we have, which is a very limited network. So for instance, Children's Hospital is not included. If you have to go to Children's Hospital, you pay out of your pocket fully. That's the extreme that you have to entertain options in health insurance in order to reduce your premiums. And then another one is a significantly high deductible, which is more common in the private sector, and we were definitely evaluating that this winter. We also discussed relooking at the GIC. We do that every year or two. Our concern historically in the last 3 or 4 years have been the subsidy the GIC receives from the state, which has been anywhere from $50 million in print to $200 to $300 million whispered. In order to sustain their low premium rates, which are lower than ours, but not a lot, they're about 5% lower than ours. We feared that once you sign up for the GIC, you're locked in for 3 years, and we feared that that would be the year that we jump in and they suddenly say, no more subsidy, premiums going up 23%. And that could happen. And that's when Governor Baker came in, that was clearly the sentiment that it would happen, and I think he realized it's much more complex than just doing that. So, we'll see what we can do on health insurance. We have done a reasonably good job, but no matter how well we do, we're not going to keep health insurance costs below revenue growth for the foreseeable future. So that's going to be a squeeze. To talk a little bit more about the litigation settlement, this is what I had just described to Dan. $6 million. There's about $800,000 in the construction fund. We had discussed during the summer $1.2 million in free cash. Given that free cash has come in at a healthy number, I certainly think there's a discussion to be had about using more free cash. We've not discussed this next one much publicly because we just don't know. But Town Council's been working with the MSBA for about a month on trying to get some reimbursement of the settlement. And it's really difficult for me to even characterize that other than it may not happen at all. If it does happen, it won't be a huge number. But every dollar we can get certainly is worth it. Once we have a discussion and decide on how much free cash to use conceptually, and we know what the construction fund is, we're never going to know the MSBA number before we have to pay it. So I would suggest, and I have suggested to our treasurer, to be prepared to borrow $4 million in temporary debt once all these numbers shake out as to how much free cash we really want to use and how much the MSBA willing to give us, then by next June, we have to know that, and we have to then borrow a permanent amount of debt. So $4 million is a temporary step. Perhaps a lower number would be a permanent step taken again by June. We cannot do this temporary internal borrowing over a fiscal year end, though. So we have to know something in June. Whatever we know, we'll do the best we can. And as I described earlier, and it's on, I'll find out what page, but there's a list of capital, the specific capital that is rearranged in this plan. It is still a draft. The November town meeting capital was not in time to change that. If you look on page 4 of tonight's handout, there is a draft suggestion of how to pay for this litigation. Depending on the timing of all this, when we know what the MSBA number is, when we know how much free cash we're going to use, this can change from a draft into a more firm capital plan to be discussed as part of FY18. So this will become public in January, but this is a first crack at it. And you can see the three areas, facilities, recreation, and public works equipment, all need to be delayed. Generally speaking, the delays are 1, 2, or 3 years, and I've discussed with all the relevant staff members on all this, and none of this is a crisis. Our former recreation director, before he left, looked this over and urged me to protect the two turf fields at the high school and not to push those out because that was a safety issue, and agreed that all the other things that are suggested here are reasonable. So to the question of how we're going to pay for the litigation, this is the answer. This is the answer. Go ahead, Barry.
So to be clear, the $4 million or maybe three, if we use more free cash, that's within the levy?
Yes.
So it's not a debt exclusion like the library or the high school?
No.
And is there any consideration to shortening up? I know it's going to be a bigger payment, but just to shorten up the length of that debt, 5 years?
Our financial advisor talked me out of that, which is very unusual. I'm usually just stubborn. You know, if you think back to the settlement, I don't really want to be paying interest on it, let's just say. So if we borrow $4 million for 10 years and we just kind of guess at an interest rate, we're going to be paying more than $500,000 of interest. If we borrow for 5 years, it's $200,000 and change. So if we stop right there, it seems like an obvious choice, borrow for 5 years. But when I actually looked at the impact on the capital plan, it was very, very difficult to borrow for 5 years and push all that capital further out. We would have been incurring operating costs for repair and on equipment. The buildings would have fallen into disrepair and probably needed some kind of roof work sooner than we thought we could afford it. So I did look at that, and I agree with you that that was the first impulse. But when I realized the cost on the capital plan, and then the financial advisor said, you know, basically if you don't borrow for 10 years, you're nuts. The interest rates are so low. I said, okay, maybe I... Because for the library, it was the same discussion without the problems of maintenance. We borrowed for 10 years. We could have borrowed for 20. It's going to be paid off very fast. If it was borrowed for 20, the payments would be less. Everyone's tax bills would be less. And the interest rate was attractive. But I don't like paying interest. You know, it's just not a good thing.
Can you prepay, Bob?
Not if you issue a 10-year or shorter, you can't. But for the high school, we did refinance that once and saved about $3 million in interest. So if you issue longer than 10, yes. So for the high school, it's a 20 or 30 year you could refinance.
We get state money, MSBA money. Let's say we get $2
million.
Whatever. Maybe
not from the Massachusetts state.
Half a million. I mean, that's money that...
We won't borrow that money. If they, you know, by June, we'll know.
We have to temporarily borrow some amount.
But they will let us know what they're going to give us, if anything, I should say, before we permanently borrow.
So that could mitigate the impact on the capital.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. And again, if the group is willing to use more free cash to make the settlement now, that helps the capital plan, just to be clear.
And we pay less interest.
Yes, we could borrow less money. Absolutely.
Right, how did you go through that balancing act as an Sure it is, you know, to.
Honestly, by looking at specific capital items, thinking how difficult it would be. You know, a couple of school roofs, the town hall roof, there's a couple of other town, I think the main fire station roof. And then looking at some equipment in DPW and recreation, it seemed like this is kind of the worst you could really realistically do to the recreation capital. And then it really became getting into fire equipment especially. All right, let's push the fire truck out a year. I said, no, I'm not doing that, I'm just not.
But why didn't you just naturally, I'm just curious, and I probably missed some of the discussions about the balancing act between free cash and borrowing, but the baseline of two and then go from there. Did you, anything?
Before we knew what, Sharon doesn't even give hints on free cash. So what I had said to her is it okay if we use $1 million of free cash to pay this? She said, sure. And then when I saw it was nine, I was like, well, we could have used two. You know, that decision has not been made. We could pay it all off in free cash, plus the construction fund. We have it. We have $9 million. It's a question of that balancing.
That's right.
And you'll see that shortly.
We're not maintaining the
7%. So even though the litigation is a new cost of capital, I've mentioned before, we used to have almost a $12 million surplus in the capital plan for the next 10 years. Now it's down to $6.5 million. So it's a difficult thing, but it's certainly in the best part of the budget to hit it. You know, it's a budget that's very healthy, the capital.
I didn't understand this chart at all, Bob. So how can you reading a surplus?
FinCom has a policy that you'll use 5% for debt and capital. We don't need 5%.
We're overspent.
We need it for the next 5 years. At some point, first of all, capital needs kind of appear eventually. So it's really hard to see what you need in the seventh year right now. So I'm not saying this is really what's going to happen, but I am saying that's what's scheduled, is there are less capital needs out beyond 6 years than we have possible funding for, given their policy.
So zero is like the 5%?
Yes.
So that is, and then that's
In the first year it isn't, because I did make it less. I took 250,000 away, but otherwise, yes, it's the 5%.
So is that 4.75?
Yes, exactly. Just to remind everyone to throw a few more things out there, the Killam School is still a project that is being evaluated by the MSBA. Was out here a week or two ago. DPW Cemetery Building is still on the capital plan. A DPW garage is a very complex issue, but someday I hope to have that discussion with you. We are trying to do it fully inside the levy by new revenues. We'll see. There is an item on the capital plan called Town and School Building Security Systems. There is no number attached to it because we have not got the results of an evaluation. Town meeting funded that evaluation last April. We expect results possibly in time for April town meeting, probably not, probably for next November. And I'm sure the evaluation will present a range of alternatives from X dollars up to Y dollars. And I fully expect some of that range to be in the millions of dollars, just to be really clear about that. And lastly, there's a high school air conditioning number in the capital plan. It may or it may not need to go forward. I know fans were put in this summer or last spring, and the result seems good. On
so
the
far.
Top floor. Yeah, so far. Don't blame.
This is not a priority of any kind, because security, I think, is really important, but this is not in any order.
No, it's kind of in a random order.
Okay.
These are just projects that are not in the capital plan with a specific number.
Okay.
And so since they're not in there with a number, they haven't been accounted for in that previous page. Okay. That's all. Now we get to the exercise part of the evening, which is, given our revenues that Sharon mentioned and the costs that I mentioned, what do the operating budgets look like and how much free cash should be used? The first slide here, and let me just line it up with some of your handouts here. If you look at page 8 in your handout, that's if we use zero free cash in FY18. And parenthetically, no free cash at all ever again. The operating budgets would be negative 0.8%. And that's a number that's right in the same ballpark as what we discussed last summer during the override. Circled on the bottom of page 8, just for everyone's understanding, is the projected municipal government budget and school budget, each around 0% total. So some accommodated costs come in above zero, but then this operating budget comes in below zero, and it works out to be 0.03 for the town and negative 11.11 for the schools. So that gives you one set of data, if you will. In your handout, I've given increments of half a million. On page 9, if you use half a million to balance the budget, you can see the operating budget's climbed to about three quarters of, well, the total budget climbed to about three quarters of a percent, bottom of page 9. The operating budgets go from a negative number to barely above zero. On page 10, that's $1 million. That's the number that Sharon mentioned was a reasonable regeneration number. I do have a slide on that one. That's an operating budget of 1%. So in contrast to negative 0.8% if you don't use free cash. And that's budgets for both the town and the schools of approximately 1.5% total. Page 11 has $1.5 million used, and page 12 has $2 million used. And you can have a look and see what those do. As has been done in the past, here's that question that Mark asked earlier. If we targeted a 3.5% rate of growth in the operating budgets, which is said to be level service, you would need to use 2.4 million free cash this year. Given all these assumptions, you'd need to use 3.6 million next year, and you would be out of money after 2 years. So as long as you're not going to be here for the third year, that would be fine. And this additional need for free cash is behind the operating override question of, we have a $3 million shortfall. And by the way, this 2.4 million, if we were going to have an override, it was 3 million because other things were put into the expenses that were not now part of it, such as increasing the pension contribution. But because of this increasing number that's very clear, that's why an operating budget shortfall might have been so much today, but it was going to get worse, and we needed to ask for a bigger number, whatever it was. And the solution to that equation is, how long do you want to fund it? So a 3.5% target right now, to me, is clearly off the table. It's just not there. So the question.
We talked about an accommodated cost deficit of $750,000 a year that year over year we see against the original proposed override. The amount of savings you'd be able to put into the pool in the first few years would diminish by $750,000 a year. And that's, if I understand your earlier chart, that's closer to $1 million or $1.2 million a year.
Yeah.
Why? Look at the chart? No, go to the next one.
But yeah, I know what you're asking. It's what you're looking at, I assume, is this difference.
Yeah.
1.2-ish.
Exactly. That's bumped down a lot higher than we were thinking.
Is
that because you get 3.5% growth and you're finding some organic growth, you're not just staying flat?
I have to think about that. There's a subtle reason. Some of it is, again, with an override, we put additional expenses into the budget that aren't here now. $350,000 was for pension, I know. There was something else too. I just don't remember what it was. But it was something else that, if we were going to ask for an override, it made sense to also accomplish this thing, whatever it was.
I see.
So there's effectively, I guess, three questions on the floor. Two of them are important for the budget process. One is, how much free cash to use for the operating budget as guidance, clearly. One is, do you continue your policy of deferring a certain amount of spending in capital? And I just picked the number 250,000 because it just so happens that the capital plan balanced and there was 250,000 left. You can do any number you want. We can rearrange capital. And then the third question, which is a little harder to say, it's ultimately a town meeting decision, I think, it's really complex, is how much free cash to use for litigation. The actual article in front of town meeting is to fund $6 million. But the motion will have to explain the ways. So effectively, town meeting has the vote on this. You can give advice and recommendation, as you probably should, to town meeting. but it is the vote of town meeting that binds the method of payment. Clearly, the $800,000 of the construction fund is a source. Free cash is optional, don't have to use any. We have to leave room in case the MSBA kicks in some money, and then the rest is debt, whatever we haven't spoken for. The more debt you do, the more difficult it is to achieve the capital plan's objective. The capital plan, while in good shape in 10 years, is only in okay shape for the next five. It's balanced, but it's not ideal. There's things being pushed out that are not ideal, but it can work. So I can't think of any other decision that, you know, needs to be made tonight. The litigation is scheduled for the first night of town meeting. It has a special town meeting on the 14th. So, you know, if it does go off on the 14th, as it may, town meeting is going to need FinCom's advice. But one of your agenda items tonight was to vote on the special town meeting. There's two articles. There is not a signed agreement, so I don't, John and I talked, and we don't think it's appropriate that you actually vote on anything tonight in terms of the litigation articles. So the special town meeting has Article 3, which is to add $6 million to the capital plan, and then Article 4, which is how do we pay for it. I don't think it's appropriate that you vote, and once an agreement is signed, we'll ask you to meet. It could just be the night of a town meeting, and it could be the same night as it's discussed even.
What's the timing we are expected?
Yeah, we met last night, so he's working on it.
Yeah.
David Dineski comes out with the council that we're using, he's working on it.
Yeah, I think the fairest conclusion is it's going to be opened on the 14th for sure as a special town meeting. If there is not a signed document, it's then a discussion point, but the next options were leave it on the table till the 21st or the 28th when the Dave Dineski attorney is available. So, you know, we won't know probably until another week or so.
So if it got delayed that way, would we have to go into special town meeting again?
The special town meeting can just stay open.
Oh, I see.
Until Christmas or whenever we're finished.
All that stuff.
It just won't be addressed on that first night.
Is the expectation then that FinCom will be dialogue about the approach on the free cash, like the approach on the settlement, and be able to?
I would think so.
But might not be able to sort of vote on it till we get that settlement. But they could sort of say, well, assuming this, then they'll make a decision about how you're going to balance the free cash and the debt, and we won't know the MSBA piece until June.
Yeah, and I guess that Barry threw some numbers out there. The lowest number he threw out there was probably higher than it will be.
Just so I said
that.
any dollar will be appreciated.
Yeah, absolutely.
Just to be clear.
So, FinCom discussion. Who wants to open?
Should we start specifically about the balance of free cash versus?
Yeah, actually, I think that I'd like to put a fourth topic on the table. So, free cash use for fiscal 18. The settlement, the assumptions that we have about state aid and health insurance, just to make sure that we're still comfortable with making up the balance out of free cash, because that's going to be a net drain.
I know. Did we just restate those assumptions this summer? Seems like a long time ago.
Yeah.
It does.
Yeah, so I think we should just kind of make sure we're comfortable with that, understand what the implication is in terms of pulling out of free cash. I think, did you want to fire away?
No, I guess building on that, it's a trying to think of the best way to start and what angle to come from, because the range for litigation, 1.2 to 2.2, in there drastically impacts, I would assume, the thought process on the guidance we would give. Like, we've been comfortable in that million and a half. I know we went just over 2 million last year, knowing that it's going to be regenerated. Now, right off the bat, we've got $1.2 million on the low end that will not be regenerated. Every year, I know I always say, sooner or later, this is going to stop regenerating, and we need to consider that. But we're, at a very minimum, looking at $1.2 million that won't be regenerated.
So the good news is that we're sitting at a position now that's in the nines.
Mm-hmm.
On $100 million roughly revenue budget, so sitting at like 9%. And we just recently, Yeah, so 9.4 to 10.5. That's based on using 1.2. So my quick take personally is that it's still in a very strong position. We just kind of reset that minimum reserves policy to 7. And I would almost suggest that we kind of separate the one-time items from the recurring. So the one-time item really is going to be the litigation piece. Mm-hmm. I mean, kind of put that to the side for a minute. What was interesting to me is kind of Sharon's reconciling the information that we're regenerating north of $1 million per year.
Significantly more.
Yeah. So to me, the notion of, you know, what's in play for a self-sustaining use of free cash, and, you know, kind of given the numbers that Bob has passed around, I mean, to me, certainly $1 million looks like it's in the range of reason. It's an annual support level based on our experience that it's regenerating.
How do we think the hiring freeze will play into, right? Is that, that continues to be a large source of regeneration.
And part of it is Bob, that actually becomes net cuts, right? So if you were needing to make cuts to balance the budget, just not filling a position is essentially doing that.
Yeah, and I should add, just for clarity, you see in the handouts that the forecasts, regardless of how much free cash you use this year, next year, rather, the forecasts beyond that are still poor. That's why we asked for the override. We'll be here, no matter what number you pick, we'll be here again doing the same thing. So I'll just speak for myself. As I'm looking at the town budgets, I'm not necessarily going to make 1 year's worth of cuts. I'm going to have to plan for more. I don't think the voters are going to go from 60% no to 51% yes in a year. I can't assume that, so I have to make cuts that will be able to sustain themselves. So, you know, whatever the number is, the town is going to prepare a budget that is also going to be flexible for that second year, let's just say. I don't want to add in permanent costs that we can't sustain.
Before you do that, any other FinCom comment?
Nothing other than I think it's going to be easiest if we sort of target our discussion to one thing at a time.
Right.
Because
So where do you want to start?
Capital. So two things on that. One is that in the last, is it 2 years that we've used less?
Yes, you've done it for 2 years.
Okay. So we've voted to shift some of the money. We've reduced the amount of money in that budget. And with feedback, obviously, from town, DPW in particular, I'm going to look at Joe also, but without incurring a problem situation. In other words, we felt comfortable in making that reduction, that it wasn't adversely impacting what we're doing, that we have enough going on. Is that still kind of the feeling?
I think the other part of that is also that capital can and almost always has been done at November town meeting. You know, capital is a one-time cost. Usually you have some one-time revenues available because your free cash is so healthy. So your policy is 5%, but that just means in the annual budget, we've done well more than 5 every year when you include all capital for the whole year. The capital plan is telling you that it's at least balanced, if not a little better, without doing any mid-year capital. But we will probably continue to do that. Not for sure. We skipped it 1 or 2 years in the last 10. So that's why I don't mind any kind of cut to capital in the annual budget, because I feel pretty confident that more often than not, we're still going to hit 5% somehow during the year. You know, even if you don't want to, there could be a piece of equipment that breaks down that has to be replaced in mid-year, in November. I think we have one example of that this year. So I personally don't have any problem with you shifting again, because we've also talked that now that the house is in much better shape, 5% is not necessarily needed anymore in the long run. It was 10 years ago when that started, believe me.
How does that square with the deferral of a number of projects that you're talking about?
They're not being deferred. purely to save money. The Killam one especially is being deferred because we, A, don't have the staffing, or maybe B, and A, do we really want to do work in a school and field that might be torn up in a few years from construction? So that's the reason for that. The Birch Meadow lighting was, you know, we put out 5 fields for bid with $1 million budget. The bids came in well over $1 million. Did we think it was a responsible thing to do only 3 of the fields for that money? No, because that's not really what we said we were going to do. You know, should we go back out to bid, you know, in the spring and get that funded? Well, it's recreation, and recreation capital, you saw, is being pushed out. So the capital that's been deferred has been a little bit different. It's not been a piece of equipment that we say, well, we know it's breaking down and it's costing maintenance money, but, you know, let's just live with it for another year. It's been different. I don't see any other capital items, by the way, that would qualify for being stopped or delayed under the same circumstances at all.
So why don't I just throw it for discussion that maintain the 5% as a guidance and shift the 0.25%? How does that feel to FinCom?
I think it's a good idea.
Like we said.
Budgeting for capital and debt, 5% of the budget. And
but basically that asterisk.
Right.
All right, then we'll need to go back up to the 5 for some of that debt.
Yeah.
Right.
Exactly.
We have a new contribution coming.
So I think somewhere in this packet I mentioned that that change is worth about 0.4% of the operating budgets, just so you have a number. It doesn't seem like a lot of money, $100 million, but in the operating budgets, that money's going right to a much smaller operating budget.
And is that shift in that minus 0.8%?
Let's see.
Is that
that's already assumed.
That's in there, right?
So if it warranted, it'd be minus 1.2. And so forth in all the other charts.
And how many comments on that as a continuation?
I would certainly support continuing it. Do we have any sense, and I don't think we would want to go there, but on a shorter term, maybe for a year or so, pushing out more than the 0.25%? Certainly don't want to go back where we came from, and,
right.
You know, but we've got some tough decisions to make. So,
you know, to go another 0.25%, find in another couple $100,000, we can always do that. But I have to tell you, once you go past where I feel okay, I'd only feel okay if I was pretty sure we'd do it in November instead of not at all or a whole year.
Yeah. Right. My concern is I feel like we're putting double pressure on through capital, right? We've got.
At some
the
point,
debt.
Yeah. Well, that's true. $4 million just sort of came in and pushed it out.
So we're putting that pressure, and then we're decreasing that. I think it might be a little aggressive.
I'm struggling with the difference between lowering capital by 0.25% and then dealing with any overages at the end of the year at free cash. Because in the end, you're just using free cash in the budget.
Yeah.
As opposed to just putting free cash into the budget in the first place. Isn't it 6 of 1, half a dozen of another thing?
What if something doesn't happen?
One you know at
right.
the time.
What if
you say, oh, we did get it, we'll spend it now, versus we're committing, and then things don't come in as you expect, and then.
Right. But if you're always at the end of the year going over the 5%, maybe I misunderstood your comment.
No, you're right, John. The question is, how much of the money goes to the operating budgets? If FinCom sticks to their current process, 5% goes to capital. Then the operating budget right here would be negative 1.2%. Now, if FinCom says, well, let's add another $250,000 of free cash, and by the way, we're going to push it to the operating budget, so that's effectively what they're doing.
Correct.
If they knock it down to 4.75%, they're effectively saying, we just put another $250,000 in the operating budget. Now, they could fund it with more free cash that year, or they could wait till November. It sort of doesn't matter. But the optics, if you do it right away, are sustainable. This is a sustainable practice. If you do it in November, it sort of seems a little different. It's like, yeah, we can afford to do this, but we had the choice.
To see your point, it's systemic versus one.
Yeah.
Episodic.
And timing.
You've got some options. Elaine?
So are you taking questions from us now, or?
On this topic, yeah. I was just kind of going through to make sure FinCom didn't have comments. Yes,
okay,
please.
I have on this topic. Something on what Paul said earlier. I'll just hold it till later then.
Please. So what, anything else on the issue of capital budget and deferral or moving the 250K? No? So should we take a vote on that? Is that the best way to do that, I think? Okay. Can I entertain a motion?
A motion to continue the practice of, I don't know how we need to word that, but
deferring a quarter,
deferring a quarter percent.
That's good enough.
You have a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed? And you're 9-0-0. Okay, topic one. Topic two, why don't we talk about the assumptions for a moment as it relates to state aid and healthcare and using free cash to make up the difference. So what we did the last 2 years, I believe, is that we've used an assumption for how much healthcare could go up. To Bob's point, it could go up, it could go down. If it goes down, we'll all be happy. If it goes above that number, that we would use the difference out of free cash. And the same thing on state aid. The state aid assumption, I think, is 2.5%, mm-hmm. and our experience has been that it's not near 2.5%. That's more of a dream kind of number. And Sharon, you, in your assumptions, you looked at about a $500,000 kind of a buffer fund. Okay. That was the assumption that we would go over somewhere between state aid and health insurance by about 500K. So that's kind of a buffer that is getting thrown into the budgets looking forward. And that still leaves that opportunity for regeneration at $1 million.
Wait, say that again. What are you saying?
So in the assumptions where we were looking at $1 million of regeneration happening per year.
Yeah.
Even
that
with
million.
That, no, not of that million.
Okay.
In addition to that million, is the assumption that we could go over the state aid and health insurance assumptions by 500K. In other words, there's an assumption one of them will be wrong, or both will be
okay.
wrong. Am I reading that right, Sharon? Wow.
I guess I remember.
On this slide?
No, actually on slide 17.
Yeah, I made a comment about that. She has not put it in any of her numbers.
Well, that's not in her.
Not in
okay.
the discussion about
Sorry.
Reserves. He right on
yes.
the screen.
Okay, that's not assumed. Okay. So that's more for us to kind of consider internally that, hey.
I just threw that on the last slide about how
yeah.
quickly you'd run out of free cash
mm-hmm.
as
yeah.
an assumption.
And so if state aid is 1.1 of the budget, I'm trying to figure out what's the
well, every percent of state aid is about 150 grand.
Okay.
So we've been running, let's just say 1% lower
yeah.
for the last few years. That's 150,000.
And do you have an idea for what 1% health insurance above estimate would be?
Yeah, it's about the same.
About the same. So the state aid one, unfortunately, okay. seems like this.
Okay.
I don't want to say thank you.
I don't want to make it a five-year average, and the reason is, and I understand it's optics. I think we should have the headline that, boy, state aid didn't come in what it should. State aid, because it's not. And it should be more than 1%. And so to me, it's about optics that I don't want to make it a five-year average because, damn. The state
yes.
aid should be higher than 1%.
So where does that volume get greater? What do we, you want to hold the assumption where it
Either
is?
Either that or 2. I wouldn't want to go less than 2. I think it's important that we hold the state to what they should be doing. I think it's woefully short.
So 2.5 is the number that's in there right now.
Mm-hmm.
Is that a reasonable number or is that something we should change?
Ask a question about this.
Sure.
So, but you said so. FinCom's has the policy that if it comes in below the budgeted amount, then you make that up with free cash.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Other way around.
If it's above that, then we make it up with free cash. Sorry.
So
state
right.
aid. State aid. You're correct. If we get more state aid, then.
But if we budget 2.5%, knowing that really that's. A percent at least, above what we're actually going to get, then in a sense, you're committing to that percent, that 150,000.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So.
But at least people understand why when it's happening.
And we haven't.
You see what I'm saying? Like, we're going to do the same mechanism that's going to happen. You're
right.
Going to
between
keep
that and health care, we haven't had to do that, correct?
Correct. 100K this last year, right?
But you're saying if we did two, then there's less to budget for and to count on.
Right. But, I mean, again, but then that, I know that that makes that number minus, minus 1.2 again or something
mm-hmm.
on the budgets, but you would just, then it, the decision is in total free cash. It's just one usage of free cash versus right now you're using some of the debt, a portion of the debt that you just diverted, and then you're infusing free cash potentially in these two areas. And then you've got to make a decision on, you know, the free cash line item. I guess that hasn't always been that clear to me about the free cash usage.
I think this way lets us kind of highlight where the issue takes place as compared
mm-hmm.
to the assumption that's in a long-term model. We could certainly lump it all together and
right.
kind of see how it nets out. But
we haven't had to put in additional free cash based on making those assumptions and making that commitment.
Because the puts and takes washed
correct.
Out.
Well, that's only because we've had other revenue.
Yeah.
Right.
You saw
right.
that slide
but also,
from Sharon, and we were
care,
short.
Healthcare has been coming in over the last 5 years,
and
less than our
there was one
assumption.
Year where it went a little higher.
Right, I'm saying
but
over
we
the
had
last
other
5 years.
Benefit savings.
Right.
Yeah, well, and generally, yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But you don't, so you don't, can I just, so if these two numbers end up together coming in low, and just those two numbers would require money from free cash, like $200,000. But then what you're saying is, if other revenues have come in higher, you don't need to take the $200,000. So we haven't really felt the impact of that, but because other revenue covered it.
If I might, this is another one of those timing and optics things. If we knew that state aid was 1% before town meeting voted, we're obliged to tell them that the revenue forecast is wrong.
Mm-hmm.
But if you use an assumption with a policy behind it, then you have the whole year to figure out how to find more revenues to make up for the loss. And the same with health insurance. You have to pass a balanced budget. So in a way, this is kind of an optics and a gimmick, if you will,
mm-hmm.
but it's a reasonable one. I think the state aid, I think it's rather interesting that state revenues are running at 4.5%. And we're wishing we had a 2.5% increase in local aid. I mean, come on. So, you know, honestly, make it 5%. You know, send the legislature a real message.
Actually,
I do
I
think
know.
The value of the message in this one is big.
Right,
2.5 is very reasonable.
We
it's
do have
to
rally, I think, as a group and really work with our state legislators. It's really disconcerting. The state aid numbers, really.
Yeah, it really
legislation
is.
Though that tied the increase of state aid, I don't know if it was a budget amendment or a legislation that tied the increase of state aid to growth of state revenue?
They did talk about that.
And
the current administration has held to that on the town side, but not school aid. And that's
so
what
just,
it was tied.
So it's just a small piece.
Yeah. A couple million out of the 13.
And the optical advantage of saying 2% have improved in budgeting, get it closer to where it really is versus 2.5. How does that help us with our...
Doesn't.
Decrease our exposure.
I wouldn't.
So why would you try to make it closer to the run rate rather than...
I admit it's
salad and total 1.6
it's accepting
million.
That's okay. That's my issue with it.
Mm.
Say again?
My issue with it is it's accepting that it's okay. That you say, okay, fine, it's 1%. And I think we should be rallying systematically as a community with our town legislator, our state legislators, and insist that something be done here.
I think I'm agreeing with you. I'm just not sure how putting a 2 versus a 2.5 on a piece of paper changes the emotion, whatever the emotion.
And it won't necessarily. I'm not prepared to make it the run rate of 1%, so, you know.
Right.
It really comes up in the noise. If you look at this year, the total overages, you know, all of them are positive this year except for state aid, and some of the years you
mm-hmm.
might have a few more years, but overall it's been positive. So
well, that's why I'm sort of comfortable not going with the run rate.
Right, it's not like you're steering the ship into danger.
Right.
Right.
Another FinCom?
Could this cut the other way, though, when we've talked about previously about hiding the cost and what it really, the the actual expense of running the town. So if we make it appear that we're receiving 2.5, it buys us time, but it makes it appear that we don't need the difference, when in fact we do need to compensate for that difference. So I feel like there's a local perception versus what we want to, not argue necessarily, but demonstrate the need for the state versus what we're demonstrating to the town.
Other comments?
Yes, I have a comment on health insurance. Just bear in mind that we don't have a requirement to contribute to OPEB. We don't have a policy on OPEB. We budget $500,000. That's always been discussed as a cushion against a rise above 7.5%. Now, it's up to FinCom ultimately, or town meeting ultimately. If something came in at 20%, I'm sure that $500,000 contribution would go to zero first. And then we'd pay, the difference in free cash. But just keep in mind, you do have another piece of the budget that can protect you against a really large health insurance increase.
Right. And our issue is not how do we spend our riches.
It's
quite the opposite.
Yeah.
Right, but we have another little issue in terms of
right, available.
Yeah, and the OPEB number should be $2 million a year, very clearly.
Right, and we could spend faster on pension if we had the money also.
Right.
But, Barry, did I see your hand?
No.
Sorry, did I see another hand? So what's on the table, folks, is what do we do with that number? Do we keep the assumption of 2.5 or do we change it? Possibility of 2, another possibility of even lower. Where do folks feel makes sense?
If we say 2, can we assume that there would be, can we make any assumptions about revenues coming in from other sources that would fill in that gap as has happened in the past, that so we wouldn't have to take from free cash?
So I think we start to get into this regeneration question now. Mm-hmm. Where do we tuck it into individual items, or do we kind of note that at the end of the day it's coming in at $1 million+? We can tweak each of these assumptions probably. So the way Sean already has with the excise taxes, where they're getting tweaked up each year, so far appropriately. Meals tax looks like it's pretty flat. It's only moving $5,000 a year. Where do we think it's going to come in this year? How's it running?
Actually, the meals tax is right on budget.
It's
not much higher.
Mm-hmm. Found the right point.
We just barely made the budget.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so there's not really room to move that one.
No, and I think as a policy matter, you don't want to have this discussion, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
We could add $5,000 or $10,000 to almost any line and not.
Yeah,
really
I don't, that doesn't move the needle.
Why
right,
lower one number
an assumption.
And raise numbers?
Yeah. So I personally, I'm comfortable at either 2 or 2.5. I don't think I would go below that.
What I've always liked about the 2.5, it's about 2.5. 2.5 has
right.
a significance in this state.
I mean, it's an assumption, but it's also a commitment, right? That will fill it out of free cash that's needed. So.
Yes, yeah. So if you look at the kind of page 4, you can see this stated short term. Page 4.
The other page 4.
Yeah, sorry. Page 4, you take the big bit. It should be at least 2.5%. It's unreasonable that it's not. While I take your point that we need to make a lot of noise, it's not acceptable.
And I think we really need to systematically do it as multiple lives and figure out what that is.
So I might be inclined to hold it at 2.5 for that reason.
I agree with that.
Will it really send a strong message?
Well, we have to send the message, right? We've got to go take it and say, look, we can't. You want us to operate, you guys have 4.5% growth, why aren't we getting it back? I mean, whatever the number is, we have to do that. Then I don't think just going to observe what we're doing and say, oh yeah, that'd be nice to give more money. What are your thoughts, guys? Where do you want to go?
I would say we leave it at 2.5.
I agree.
I'll make a motion to leave it 2.5.
There we go.
Further discussion? In favor? Opposed? We are 9-0-0. Hold. Okay, those assumptions hold. That's item 2. Sorry, I lost my cheat sheet. So does that move us to FY18?
Do we also vote on the health insurance assumption?
Oh, sorry. Yeah, I kind of just jumped over that one. So Bob, last year, what was the actual that health premium increase came in? Around the 7.5?
I think 7.8.
7.8. So pretty close. A little bit higher.
Yeah, and we had lower enrollments, so we didn't need to. The budget was self-sustaining, even at budget at 7.5.
Bob, you said you think there might be some discussions with the unions that might at least cap costs to where they...
You know, we can rearrange things, but we have no real control over inflation of the product.
Right.
So it's really hard to say. It really is.
And how does that process work to look at different types of plans, like a high deductible plan? You put it out to bid for certain types of plans?
No, we're committed for at least another year to Maya Blue Cross Blue Shield. So
okay.
It's a question of what they are willing to offer. And we did discuss last year, but it was too late, in my estimation, in the process of a new plan. That anytime we're going to make a change, one of the responsibilities that at least I have, and I know the unions agree, is don't put out a new plan that someone is going to take because it's a lower premium and they don't understand what they're getting into in
mm-hmm.
terms of risk.
Mm-hmm.
So all of a sudden you can't go to Children's Hospital. Oh, I didn't know that. I thought I was saving a couple hundred bucks a month.
No,
so
agree on the restrictions.
We do things carefully,
mm-hmm.
But it has to be a plan that's offered through our current vendor.
I see. And that's one more year?
Yeah.
And I can't see why we would move the number
year
over year. I think it's the same argument, right?
Yes.
Yeah. I think that I heard a number published today that said that, you know, there was that crazy double-digit number, but I think on average, it's between 4 and 7 is what's been coming in.
Oh, I've never heard anything that low.
No. Well, I can say based on personal experience, that's exactly what happened.
Really? Our retirees just got a mid-year 9.6% increase starting January 1st. And that's almost all prescription drugs.
So
I think prescription drug inflation right now is 27%. It's a pretty big piece of everyone's health insurance. So this is a thing that, you know, there's just no way to guess, honestly. You can look backwards,
yep.
You can estimate things, but I don't know what you do.
No,
the only thing I know is that this country cannot continue with 10 to 20% annual health insurance costs.
Sorry.
It just
correct.
Can't.
Nope.
Something will change.
I think 7.5 stays a reasonable number to fill us home.
Yeah.
I'll move that we keep the number at 7.5%.
Second.
All those in favor? Yeah, opposed? 9-0-0 on that. Okay, fiscal 18.
Or litigation.
Yeah, litigation.
Or litigation.
Litigation.
I would prefer to talk litigation first.
Same.
Let's do it. You've got the floor.
I don't know the answer, but I just...
We think, you know, if it was one person, if we have to make up a 1% difference on state aid and health insurance, we think that would be in the order of 300,000.
Yeah, 350 to 300.
So I'm just thinking about what our state balance is, subtracting that, what we have left, and what would be, therefore, you know, in light of that, what would be appropriate to allocate towards the settlement in free cash.
remembering.
And still keeping in mind our 7% target.
Right, and that this use of free cash is a one-time use.
Mm-hmm. I think with the regeneration that we had last year, it would seem appropriate, since we have a one-time item, to maybe use more of it to settle the one-time item. I mean, it's there for one-time items, so.
It's what it's there for.
Yeah.
Yeah, this is the best use of free cash, is to use it for one-time items. While giving us flexibility to operate the town.
I feel like if you start with a lower number, start at the 1.2, understand what we might get from other sources to help with this, and then backfill might be a safer, more conservative option. We may end up using that amount, to Peter's point, we may end up taking anything we regenerated and using that. But again, I wonder, we start low and then build up, as we don't know kind of where our priorities are going to be going forward.
Well, we know this is out there, so if we spend free cash now, it'll regenerate later because we won't be spending it later. And we've got it now, so.
To win that, yeah.
Yeah.
I see that point.
So you're leaning towards using like 2 or something.
Yeah.
Same.
Yep.
Yeah. But that regeneration number, I think it's the right use of free cash and puts less strain on the
And I don't know what we're earning on those funds, but
not much.
Not much. And it's less than what we'd be spending even to do short term notes, right?
Oh yeah.
I hate borrowing too.
You might come that bamboo business.
You borrow $1 million less that way.
Yeah.
It is a great point when we think about regeneration that, yes, I know I had said earlier, great, this is a use of the cash, it won't regenerate. You bring up a good point. Yes, it doesn't regenerate in the first year, but it has.
But we don't have to spend it later.
Right, exactly. So if you take a longer term view at it, yes, it does have some regeneration to it. Didn't look at it that way originally.
No comments?
And this we're not voting on. We're not voting on this because there's no sign
of giving kind of a general sense of.
You could vote on it. Technically, what you can't vote on, or what we don't think we should vote on, is something that's in front of town meeting. This isn't yet in front of town meeting, the number itself. So I think you can vote on it as guidance,
as a
just
general,
like you've done the other thing.
How much to use at free cash for litigation in general.
Okay. Lane, go ahead.
Yeah, so then I agree with Peter and Paul, and Barry sort of made the point earlier to Bob, that I do think that it makes a lot of sense, and especially given where we are with free cash, so well over the 7%, to use the 2 or 2.2 million, and put us in a position of borrowing less, and then hopefully MSBA will put us in a position of borrowing even maybe another small amount less than that. And, we'll all pay less interest because we're borrowing less, even though we're going to do the 10-year term. So I totally support that. I'm happy with that decision.
Public comment on that? So, to give a sense, I guess, is what we want to do at this point. Comfort. Is the number
2.2?
All in.
Although it's only all in because Bob came up with 2.2.
That's right.
Yeah, 2.2 of the speech chart makes it easier.
0.8.
Right.
You
so
pick any number you want.
Yeah, impact on year would be.
Now I get the significance of 0.2.
So the impact here would be $1 million less, so that 8.6 to 9.6 would be 7.6 to 8.6.
No,
it
would
be
8.6.
Oh, 8.6, sorry, that is the range. So it would be 8.6.
And it would be 9.4%.
Which is pretty good on our reserve position, right?
Yeah.
It's great on our reserve position.
Right.
I have to step out from it, but I am comfortable with higher.
Right.
So I would say, just to put a number there to get us talking, right, more specifically, I would go to the 2.2. We had long and detailed conversations about what the 7% should be. We all got to the point that 7%, was reasonable, was where we thought we should target. And certainly, because there will be times when we need to use that money, you know, that's above and beyond. So going to the 2.2 still holds to, I would say, all of the discussions we had around the 7%.
Another comment? No, all good.
So 2.2, do we offer that as guidance, or do we have a?
I like the idea of voting on it. If it's perfect.
Would you like to make a motion?
I'd like to make a motion that we dedicate $2.2 million in free cash for any litigation settlement that we come to.
Should we say state that as guidance, or is it a commitment?
I always change your mind. Don't worry.
Is it everything?
Okay.
Everything we do guidance.
Second.
Okay.
I think you got a question up there, Mark.
I'm sorry, John.
Mark, so there's actually $10.8 million in free cash, right? Put back in the 1.2 on top of the 9.6, you get the 10.8, right? Before the
yes.
Before the other.
Correct.
So if you take two out of that, you're at 8.6. That leaves you for your policy 1.3 million that you can put back into the budget for next year. You guys comfortable doing that? That's really the question.
That's not the question at the moment, though. That'll be the next question that we deal with.
They're not related.
They're very related. We just kind of have to go in order, but yeah.
Well, and it relates to regeneration too.
Yeah,
so.
True.
Yeah.
True.
This is one time.
We assumed some level of regeneration.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
So, question for Bob. In the packet, you sort of gave a detailed list of deferred capital. That assumed, I think, just $1 million use of free cash.
$1.2 million, right?
$1.2 million. So. You know, obviously, it's $1 million of additional capital that doesn't have that
over
come
10,
off that
over
list.
10 years. Yeah.
Is there anything that you know jumps at you as like sort of how you change that?
I'm sure I'll get some suggestions very quickly from the audience. You know, it's about $125,000 a year, ballpark. I'm sure there's things we can just put back in that we just pushed out. I couldn't tell you offhand that there's
right, and
something
if things didn't really
need.
Push right in, it's another opportunity to do another 0.25% down and give more to the operating budget.
And if we're lucky enough to regenerate more than this $1 million, then we've got more flexibility again.
I mean, the point that I'm trying to make here is that while we're deferring capital costs as a way to kind of squeeze in funds to you know to pay for litigation or other obligations. Deferring capital has a cost.
Absolutely.
And, you know, so that's why I'm glad that you are using more free cash and borrowing less, and that impacts that less. But, you know, it's hard to quantify what that cost is because you don't know what's going
right.
to happen. But it's not just, you know, pushing pieces on the board. It does have a cost. And we've paid that price before when we didn't pay attention to capital. So.
Taking the flip side of that, I don't think I'd be comfortable suggesting more than $2.2 million out of this right now, and then pushing it back to other things. Personally, I think that's kind of the right number. Are we ready for a vote? Also, what's on the table is to offer up to $2.2 million. In use for the litigation settlement from free cash.
Once we go into the discussion of the fiscal year 18 budget, are we locked into this dedicating this 2.2? Can we change our mind depending on what comes of that conversation? Are we offering this as guidance?
Goal would be no.
Well, we change our mind tonight, so we'll be a little funny. Right?
Yeah, I think we're setting policy here, and then we'll move on to the operating budget.
If I could, Mark.
Yes, please.
The motion at town meeting will have to have some specificity to it. I would suggest the most important specific number is how much debt is your authorizing debt. So given your discussion,
right.
I would say $3 million of debt, and then I would say up to $2.2 million of free cash to be reduced by any MSBA reimbursements, as an example. Because debt's the number you got to nail down at town meeting. We're not going to know what that is, whereas free cash, you don't really have to. Nail it down as quick. It's just up to, you know, town meeting will have authorized up to 2.2, but we have to borrow an exact number.
So should our vote be on free cash, or should it be on that debt number?
I think it should be the debt number.
Yeah, it doesn't matter, either one.
So I'll make a new motion.
Please.
To dedicate $3 million in debt towards any high school litigation.
Should it be three or up to three?
I think it's three.
Three, because it's up to 2.2.
Okay, great, okay, 3 million. Okay, we need a second.
Second.
Sorry, the question about up to, like, is that appropriate considering the MSBA potential money?
The MSBA would then get...
Reduce the free cash.
Reduce free cash.
Okay.
Okay, you ready for a vote on this one? All those in favor? Opposed? We are 9-0-0. Okay. Free cash for fiscal 18.
I'll get swamped.
To the numbers.
Okay, next.
So I think one data point we have is the feedback from Sharon that $1 million, she sees it as being essentially self-sustaining plus. In other words, a reasonable assumption at this point. Could it be a little bit higher based on experience? We can certainly discuss that. Does it need to be lower and keep us somewhat self-sustaining? You know, the opinion at this point, I'd say no, it doesn't need to be lower than that.
All right, so in theory, we could dedicate $1 million and not expect any change to free cash.
Any down change.
Right.
Right. So what do people think about a number bigger than $1 million?
Well, it's the $1 million plus the cushion on the health and the cushion on the state aid.
That's right.
Right, so we call that 250 to 300, roughly. That's a point on each.
Does it change this
one? Okay. Any other comment? Yeah, so we've got a pretty, actually, we have a very good picture of that on
page 3. So last year we did 2.15, the previous year 1.5, the previous year 1.7, previous year 1, and the previous year 1. Personally, I feel comfortable taking it back a little bit from what we did last year, but I'm comfortable with 1.5.
Yeah, so we got the 2.2, we're saying 0.3 each, roughly, 2.5 we're using already.
Here, 1.5, feel like a cross, right?
Right, so we're seeing ourselves as a
right, that's net, but if you look across the
point something,
that's percent. That's a nice number.
Right, that's where I was going. Right,
sorry,
so
9.4.
We've got, so we're going to the 8.6 using 2.2. Mm-hmm. Right, we're assuming a point on each is going to bring us down to 8.3. If we right 8.3, if we're saying we regenerate about $1 million, but we're talking about using $1.5 million, that's going to bring us to 7.8.
$1.3 million, right?
I know I'm double counting something.
He just wanted $1.5 million. $1.5 million.
I know.
Healthcare.
The million's already in that number.
You got 2.2.
Yep. Mm-hmm. And 2.2. Yep.
$1 million.
That's on the schedule.
Yeah.
No, but if we're talking about putting $1.5 million.
It's really half a million dollar. It's really a half a million movement.
Yeah, right. See where would that move us?
It's another $500,000.
Right, half a million. So that puts us down. Just trying to see where that.
Yeah, so where that lands us.
Right, and then the problem now you have is that your regeneration assumption is only $1 million.
Mm-hmm.
So unless we're willing to take that assumption up, which I don't think is the right thing to do.
No, that's a nice surprise.
Yeah, I keep that conservative.
Right.
I'm comfortable with $1.5 million, too.
I'm kind of squeaky on $1.5 million.
Okay.
It feels like too much.
Beyond $1.5 million or at $1 million?
At $1.5 million. In other words, an allocation of $1 million.
Yep.
And then understanding we've got a potential for another $300,000 plus coming through.
Right.
That's my personal opinion. What other people feel?
Yeah, that's too big a number. I mean, unless it's another one-time item, but that would come either, well, comes around, we don't know right now if there's any other fixed surprise that would come up. I mean, basically, I'm saying we can use the other half of the million later on if we have another new reason, but based on
right.
budgeting, I'd stick to the million.
Eric, what are your thoughts?
Curious as to where Paul landed in this background up there.
Yeah, well, it came back to, yeah, whether or not that we go with the extra half million, so it would be, sorry, I kind of gave up on my calculation as we were talking. So 2.2, this is going to take you, right, so it's 8.3. If we use a million, we'll regenerate a million. Based on that, would put us at 8.3 is where I was going.
Next year, but then
yeah.
conceivably it goes down each year.
Right. But that's going to change. So I was just trying to say, right, does that add a million or a million five? Does mm-hmm. that still keep us, where does that keep us in terms of any level of cushion above our 7%? I was just trying to roughly recalculate back to the 7%.
So you're about a million? Over the 7 tip. Yeah.
I'm
1.5 too. So you're?
I'm 1.5 because I feel like we put in 2 million last year. So we're reducing what we put in last year. So it's not like we're, you know, just kind of bumping the number forward. I feel like we are taking a step back, but not so much that regeneration has always been well over a million every single year. And I feel like we need to start building that into things in reality. At least in our thought process as we're looking at these numbers versus saying, oh, we don't know. We kind of do know. So we should kind of put that through our assumptions as we're, at least for discussion purposes.
And it's still significant cuts. That's, you know,
yeah.
barely 2% increase. That's cuts across the board.
Right.
But isn't that what we expected? Because we didn't get the override. It's mm-hmm. cuts.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. But I don't want to put on
so
the
if you take it out of free cash, you're pushing it another year down the road. And it's only half a million more pushed down the road, but it's, you know, it is being pushed.
Mark, what was your reasoning for a million?
I feel like we're kind of pulling on all the different strings around this, what we've been sitting in free cash. And I'd like to have another year kind of to see where it really comes out. You know, if we continue to regenerate the way we're regenerating, we've attributed a lot of it to luck and not being able to find the right people at the right time, actually. I don't know that it can continue. We're going to take, you know, we're sitting at, say, 10%. We'll take that down a little bit so that we're above our 7, and I love being above the 7. I'd rather be in a position where we're close to being sustaining or self-sustaining. And you know, I don't know that the number's a million, but that's kind of, you know, Sharon's take is a million seems to work. Maybe you can push it a little bit. 1.5 million seems like too much to me.
Oh, so actually, Elaine had a question
sorry.
First. Go ahead.
I guess I just had a comment earlier. Paul, around the budgets, had talked about some, you know, hiring freeze on the town side, and I just wanted to make it clear that for the schools, there are only a very small number of powers that were unfilled, so that there was no, you know, that it will be, this is going to be cut. So the override failed, and these, you know, that's the impact. So there's not that cushion. I just wanted to make sure that people understood that. We just, you know, we've already made some cuts in that area. I just want to make sure that that was clear.
John.
I just wondered if the Finance Committee would wrap their heads around maybe taking some risk on the policy for 1 year. You just swallowed a 2.2 one-time settlement cost. That ain't coming back.
Correct.
And 1 year would be, 1 million would be historically low against where you've been. You're funding it at a certain level. If you drop it, you're actually creating a lot of stress by dropping it, any kind of systemic. I'd take some risk on the policy. I know you just raised it to 7.
But we don't even have to take it. Change on the policy and here. Still do 1.5.
1.5 and 2.2, so 3.7, and you had 10.8, so they get you back to
million generation.
With an assumption of a million regeneration.
So we're still within our policy, is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
With regeneration.
It's pretty.
Yeah.
You guys have been pretty conservative, a million or a million and a half. finance committees in the past have been okay with 2 million. And the 2.2 is why you're all kind of getting tied to that. But that's not coming back. So
right.
Take some risk and let it go.
Thoughts?
I think this goes back to hiding the cost of what the reality of running the town. And if we continue to fall back on the cash, and we're being told by our town accountant that it is unsustainable in the future, we're being unrealistic about our budget. And the override did fail. We know that a consequence of that is going to be cuts. It's unfortunate to say the least, but I think we need to be forthcoming with the residents. This is what it costs to run the town. We are fortunate that we have a healthy balance in free cash, but we've seen the charts. It's not sustainable past a couple of years beyond a certain
point. But for the last 5 years, we've more than made up for what our assumption was that we're going to need. We've regenerated more than what we expected to use for 5-6 years. I mean,
but last year we only regenerated $500,000, right? Isn't that the number?
Last year we regenerated $3 million.
But $500,000 more than what we budgeted. So our free cash is going up by $500,000.
But if you look, I think the lowest number of regeneration is 1.3 in 2010. And the next one up is 1.5, correct? Am I looking at this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you're reading
it. So if that's what I mean, I feel like we're picking a number that's at the bottom of our regeneration. So I don't feel like we're doing anything crazy by saying, all right, we can't guarantee this, but based on some pretty good history that Sharon's been nice enough to provide us, it's a pretty good number.
But when we dig down into what those numbers are and where the regeneration is coming from, it's things like empty positions or unfilled positions. So presumably those would need to be filled.
Which right, but that generated 3.7, and we're saying 1.5. So.
Mm-hmm. And it's been year after year. I'm not saying 1 year. I mean, look at these numbers: 3.7, 3.4, 3.8, 3.25. I mean.
And I it can come across in our messaging too, right? Ed, to your point, I definitely understand we don't want to hide the cost of what it truly costs to run the town. At the same time, we don't want to get that message across by cutting things we may not need to cut. If we put this, let's say 1.5, right, in right now, as long as we are very clear that, hey, we got to a point where presumably there are still fairly significant cuts, but we are very open and very transparent with the fact that even to get to this point took a use of, you know, free cash.
Part of the criticism is that we sit on a lot of cash and all of a sudden it magically regenerates. So I feel like we have, it's a little bit of an obligation to at least recommend a little bit more money.
Yeah, and that's partially because of conservative assumptions that we have in play.
Right.
Bob had a comment.
Yeah, I have somewhat of a minority view here. I think it's reckless to use free cash to begin with. Hmm. I think $1 million is justifiable based on the town accountant's comments. Any more is not, period. We went to the voters and asked for an override because our sustainable revenue was not providing enough money for our sustainable costs. You're trying to fix that with one-time money. It's not right. It's as simple as that. The answer is you've got to cut your sustainable costs to match what the problem is. Look at these numbers on the chart for operating budgets in the future. You can make the one a two tonight by using more free cash. You're going to make the future worse. The more you use now, the worse the future looks. It's time for the town to take its medicine. That's what the voters said, period.
But Bob, my concern is in the meantime, we're building up free cash.
Do you see what these operating numbers are going forward? That's 5 more years
right,
of cuts.
But it assumes 1 million regeneration. That just hasn't been what we've seen. My concern is,
if you build the $500,000 in now, then next year's gonna be worse. You can
exactly
need more than, you can need, well, 2.5% more than $500,000, whatever, however you want to look at it.
But are we tapering anyway? We're at 2.1,
right.
Or what do we have, 2.1 last year, so now we're tapering it down. So we are recognizing that there is some strain on the budget,
but
by tapering it, so we go down a little bit more.
Budget by by committing to that now, you're going to be committing to the...
Understood, as we've always said. My concern is being shocking our system so much that we go from 2.1 to 1. It's, again, with 1.5, that's cuts. And I don't want to send this message, too, that, oh, we're going to show you voters that the pain. I'm trying to be realistic for... and handling the regeneration we've had. This isn't a one-year blip that we've seen. I think it's responsible to think we might regenerate more than $1 million.
Even working on an assumption that you are correct and that we will regenerate more than $1 million annually, by looking at these numbers, regeneration is not increasing at a rate that would be able to balance the budget annually anyway. So we're going to, even if we change how we balance the budget, taking in more of this regeneration, we're still going to need an override. We're still going to be short.
Agreed.
Over the course of X number of years.
Right.
So we're just delaying the inevitable.
I will accept that we will have to look for another override and understand other years when we've need overrides. The first one didn't fly, and it took multiple years, and I accept that that may be the same situation.
And doesn't this add one more bullet point to the, to say, hey, well, here's why we need an override, because we've used as much free cash as we possibly can to help, and now we're done.
Yeah, maybe even a little more.
Right, and I don't know. I mean, I can see both sides of it, to be honest.
I have two questions. These charts shows what they're talking about. I'd love to have it up there just so that somebody can talk about it.
Are you talking about free cash and regeneration?
The regeneration.
Page three.
Okay. So if you look at this page three, it shows you each year what we started off with certified free cash, and then it shows you a favorable variance for that fiscal year, like what we turned back. And it shows the deduction of what you used in that year, and then that is how much it goes up each year.
So what's built into the favorable variance? That's
actuals and
that's
then million
that's
is
the whole budget.
More income and spending less.
Right, it's the whole budget.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay. So
that's regeneration.
Right. So part of the regeneration this year was unfilled positions. That goes into that.
That was $1 million.
But not necessarily.
Well, he's saying on the town side, but we had positions that were unfilled for a while, too. And I just have another, a comment I think Paul referred to, and you're talking about being transparent and making sure that people know that this is what we're doing, but people don't really get that. All they get is what they see at the very end. And so people won't understand that we're using free cash and we're using more free cash and we keep putting ourselves in a more precarious long-term position. People don't see that. We can't get the details out beyond this room, frankly. And so, I just think you have to be cognizant of that nobody's gonna realize, oh, right, like we failed the override, but thankfully the town stepped up and used that additional free cash, but the situation is really still very dire. They won't see that. It just will be, you guys told us you were gonna cut 11 positions, the school said this is gonna mean 30, and it didn't. And then, other people who voted no for the override are gonna say, boy, what happened? See, they're not transparent. They didn't do what they said they were gonna do.
No, I hear that.
And that's how it will look. That's where people see, is where they walk every day and where they live, and they're gonna think that we weren't serious about it. See, that's why we can't trust them. That's why we have to fail overrides twice. Don't get me wrong, because it is gonna be painful, and there's gonna be long-term repercussions for it. But it's what the community said they wanted from us.
So I think the reality is let's say we go to the 1.5, and let's say that we don't regenerate more strongly than that. So in year one, we probably still sit at or above 7%. Year two, we probably are at it or below it. And it kind of sustains from there. So what we might be doing is kind of pushing out a little bit more of the pain a year or two.
Well, you're not only pushing it out, you're making it bigger. That's
right.
The problem.
Right.
You're accelerating it.
Right.
I mean, if you look back at 2014 and 15, where we regenerated 3.8 million, 3.4 million, and then look at the fact that we ended up spending it all at subsequent town meetings, pretty much.
Yeah.
And we'll lose that flexibility if we put in, if we keep increasing the amount of free cash that we're using.
Right, those were conscious decisions with one-time opportunities.
Yeah, but are we not going to have those anymore?
Or not have the opportunity to do it because we don't have free cash.
Yeah,
well,
yeah, and it's,
that's
it's operation versus capital now, too.
Right, that's true.
We're deciding, you know, capital projects or town meeting versus operating activities going on.
Well, don't forget it could snow for $750,000 more or some year.
It has.
That's true.
Yeah, we're going to help less snow.
So. Do we talk about a number in between, maybe?
I think I can. I would be comfortable doing something like that.
Yeah. Hmm. So what I mean, I'm not. So I'm not I'm
and
not.
We don't all have to be in 100% agreement.
That's oh, that's right. I know.
That's the nice part of it. Very committee.
Yeah. 0-0
Just kidding.
Well, do you want
to? So I'll get my motion out there to use 1.5 million of free cash to balance the budget.
I'll second that.
Okay. Take a vote on 1.5. All those in favor? 1, 2, 3. 3. All those against? Sorry. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 3, 6, 0. Okay. Why don't we try the next number?
Hey, what's it?
I did my number, someone else do.
All right. I'll make a motion to use 1.2 million, and the reasoning behind that, right? Is not just a let's meet halfway. It's we always assumed some level was going to be used in it, right? Roughly $1 million. We've always used something in free cash. I think we went to the town, we went to the voters, we asked for an override. Their response was no, we don't want it. They are expecting cuts, whether I personally agree with them, the decision or not. They were expecting cuts. We should, you know, we should kind of follow along with that order. We are expecting some level of increase from increase in our spending, our contribution of free cash from state aid and potentially from insurance. So, you know, I think it is a giant step down from where we were at the 2.1. But, you know, we need some level to contribute and to move things forward. So.
And to be clear, 2.1 didn't offer level services.
Yep.
So we're chopping from a chop.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. So most of that 2.1 wasn't that for the healthcare really? Isn't that what we attached to?
Right, the 2.1.
The 2.1, didn't we put that in there because of the healthcare increase that we anticipated?
150,000 came in on the floor town meeting to do a capital project.
Okay.
No,
oh,
I think
so
it was the security
with two?
System. Yes. I think it was the security system, Joe. Does that sound right?
Okay, so more than
I
to
just
want to
remind FinCom that you've discussed what if health insurance is a percent higher? What if it's 10% higher?
Then whatever.
There's no magic. I mean, state aid will not go to negative 5%, but health insurance, you don't know.
Mm-hmm.
You know that's what I worry about.
So make that as a motion?
Motion, 1.2.
We have a second.
I'll second that.
Okay, all those in favor of 1.2? 6, 7. All those opposed? 7-2-0. Any other public comment? I think we're going to... We have a couple other items, but they're not. We're not voting on the warrant, so that's off the table, right?
Right.
Any other public comment before we move on to other business? No. Thank you. You're all welcome to stay. Thank you, folks.
Larry, Barry.
All right. So let's go 2 minutes. August 31st.
No, I wrote the help.
Motion to approve the minutes from August 31st.
Second.
All those in favor of approving August 31st minutes? August 31st minutes?
August 31st minutes?
We're voting to approve the minutes of August 31.
Thank you.
We're going to give one more second here. Thanks, Sharon. We ready for a vote?
Wow, he did agree. I'm not going to let it run out for him today. He's definitely coming to see you guys at your meeting on the 14th or 15th.
Okay, let's vote. All those in favor of accepting the minutes of 8:31, raise your hand, please. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. All those opposed?
Yeah, it was good.
8-0-1.
Not late.
Okay, let's go to 10-4.
That's exactly where I was at.
Any comments or typos on the 10-4 notes? No, we good?
Motion to approve the meeting, the minutes of meeting from October 4th.
Second. All right, all those in favor of accepting the notes from October 4th, raise your hand. And opposed? And abstain? 8-0-1. Other business, do we have anything else? We probably should just talk through what we've just done here. And make sure we're all clear. So we've set up to 2 points. First of all, we accepted the assumptions in the model. And those were the assumptions in the model that was used toward the override.
Sorry, can you speak up a little bit?
Yeah, sorry. Can I also sit back?
It's really hard. Should we make a circle?
I'm just kidding. You know what?
Okay, maybe we should.
I'm just going to stand up.
There's a lot of seconds in that meeting.
What's that?
Yes, I did a lot of seconds in that meeting.
Yeah. I did too, but I was the man who was kidding.
And also, we can talk about next week. We're scheduled 11 meeting next week. We kind of accomplished a ton tonight. So what do we do? One, we reaffirm the assumptions that are built into the model. It's the same model that was used toward the override as well. It's kind of looking out for those projections. We basically affirm all the assumptions that we made there. So 2.5% on state aid, which is high. 7.5% on health care, as usual. We cringe and pray that comes in close. We're gonna move a 0.25% out of our 5% capital and debt budget toward the operating budget. Continue with that. Third thing is we said 2.2 million of free cash toward the settlement, meaning that the debt is kind of 3 million is the way it was voted through.
Up to 2.2 and.
Yeah, up to 2.2. Again, depending on how MSBA discussions go, we probably should all talk to our reps, state reps, a lot, and just make sure that they have their face in this. I'm sure that they do, but it wouldn't hurt to hear from them. And then the last piece is we just said 1.2 million towards operating budgets to give guidance to everybody for
the
budget plan.
We have a ball.
So that's actually a lot.
We did.
Yeah, I think
we should get that done.
Yeah,
that's sure. In good time,
too. Yeah, so I assume that we're, based on our votes, we're fairly comfortable with that in most cases. It's good we don't have all unanimous votes. It's nice to see a what else? So hopefully, if you haven't seen the selectmen meeting, I think it's worth seeing just to kind of get the feedback that came through from the community.
Sometimes you can fast forward.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you. It's not like one of those shows that you're watching.
Right.
It might not work.
It kills the speed. You know.
You watch this for a full hour.
So that's all good. Any comments, questions on anything?
Are we having a meeting next week?
That's the next topic.
Yeah.
So I'm not sure what there is to discuss next week, right?
Yeah.
If we have more information, I'll let us know
on that. I don't think you will on litigation, honestly.
Yeah. So I don't think that this
will. We won't be long.
I can give you right if you need to.
I will let you know whether you need to meet ahead of a town meeting. We'll probably post you for every night just in case at 7 o'clock.
Yep.
The first night's usually difficult because it's precinct meetings. Well, not it doesn't matter so much in November.
I know, just
there's one, I
there's
think.
One just,
you know, we met last night.
I think it's
school, John, Dean Borowski, John Halsey, myself, and attorneys from each side. None of us have any idea when there'll be a settlement signed. So we'll discuss the real possibility of open the meeting.
We had a visit.
John and I agreed. We didn't really talk with the two chairs about not comfortable asking to vote on something that doesn't exist. And has been signed.
And that gives us a bit of a window because of the length of town meeting, too.
Right.
Oh, hopefully something comes through.
Absolutely.
Yeah. The good side of that, the weird perversions. Okay, yep. So I think the answer is let's not meet next week. We'll be posted in advance of the town meetings at 7. If something's coming up, we'll
just have to let you know.
Heads up that we plan on being there. I think we did a lot. Anything that we didn't?
Yeah, it's 1-1 in the third.
Oh, right.
That was a little while.
Put that in the minutes.
Right.
I'm from near Cleveland, so this is a.
Oh.
Just a minute, I was still in the last 1-1 in the third.
Oh. Quite a series.
So, you folks, you guys are comfortable with the process as it goes forward now?
Yeah, we were
involved. I think everybody else actually, you were here the last cycle, weren't you?
Yeah,
we handed you the.
It was very.
I think last year was his fault.
It's this evil circle.
We're good. I'd entertain a motion.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
All those in favor? Opposed, 0-0. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Good meeting.
Yeah.